There is a panacea. The vision of oneness is a panacea. It is a cure-all. There is a cure-all, no question about it. So we continue our close look at this cure-all. The vision of oneness cures everything that we want to have cured, for sure. There's no question about it. So it is super, super valuable. Let's talk about valuing, because valuing is something, you know, the world overlooks some key areas, and that's what I'm focusing on for the most part. One of those key areas is that valuing, we perceive what we value and we don't perceive what we don't value. The ego values the valueless and sees the valueless as very valuable. It really does, and it cons us because it acts as if it's seeing something very valuable, but the ego believes the valueless lies are valuable. Well, they're valuable because they keep the ego thinking that it's some separate will, and it's not. So of course the ego values lies. But what are lies? They're worthless. They're no value to us whatsoever. So we tend to be intrigued about the ego. Why is it valuing? I can't seem to figure out what it's valuing. It's valuing nothing. It's valuing the valueless. So there isn't any value to anything that the ego is impressed with and is telling us is valuable. Nothing, no value to it whatsoever. Only the vision of oneness has value. This is all important, because only the vision of oneness reminds us of truth. This world doesn't remind us of truth at all. Not at all. It actually reminds us of the meaningless, but that's not a reminder. It's more like a blank mind, because reality doesn't have anything. It's not, there's no meaningless there, so how can we remember it? We can't really remember it. But we're intrigued by it because we think it's mysterious. It's mysterious. What is the mystery? You know, everybody here thinks there's some big mystery, and they think that they're getting it. There is no mystery. There is no mystery. None whatsoever. We're thinking, how did the ego get to be a separate self? It didn't. So there's no mystery of how it did the impossible. It didn't. How did God make all this? God didn't. See, there's no how to it. Or why did God do this? This is a big question. I got to answer this question. Why did God do that? God didn't do this. Didn't do all of this. That's the answer. So there's a lot of questions that actually are misleading. There's a lot of interest. Like, well, how did the ego manage? It didn't manage. It's like, how did that rope turn into a snake? You're looking at that's amazing. Now, it used to be a rope, now it's a snake. How did it turn into a snake? It didn't. It didn't turn into a snake. And how can the ego get the vision of oneness? It can't. It can't. Doesn't value it. It sees no value whatsoever in the vision of oneness. And therein lies the problem, is we're so used to following the lead of the ego's valuing that we have the most incredibly difficult time even focusing at all on the issue of the vision of oneness. I know I certainly did. Lifetime of trouble with it. And I can just see everybody has the same problem. You cannot focus on what you don't value. You can't. You can't focus on it. It's impossible. You cannot do it. You can try, but I can't keep my mind on it. You know, it's too difficult. So really, the spiritual path involves this very tough work of trudging along, brick by brick by brick, we're changing our valuing. Changing our valuing. Changing our valuing is all important. That is why the value conflict in the world is so super important. Right now, the world is locked in this tremendous conflict over values, and that is super important. Because we see what we value. We interact with what we value. And we ignore what we don't value. And we ultimately don't even see it. So when we talk about parting of the ways, it has to do with values. I think someone of the posters here mentioned of you will find as this parting of the ways takes place is people will run into you like they didn't even see you. People have different value structures, and that's exactly what just happened to me a couple a week ago or something. It's exactly what happened. And I had a premonition it was going to happen too. And son of a gun, if someone didn't turn around and just go smack, boom, right into me, like they're both just like, whoa, what happened? You know, it's like I didn't really register. You know, I saw it kind of coming. I just said, uh-oh. I said, what? And I said, boom. I said, okay. Different valuing structures. Sometimes people, you'll think that you don't exist because people don't even pay attention to you because you have a different value structure. So this is something we overlook, is the importance of valuing, and these kind of things take a long time to sink in because we don't value this information, we don't value it, so we can't really focus on it. We can't really do it. People focus on the person, the speaker. You know, okay, I could see a body there. I value bodies, but the actual information, we just have a difficult time. And if you think you're having a difficult time, everybody does. Everybody does. I've had a super difficult time with it. And I was very super smart, but that doesn't matter. It's not a question of how smart you are, it's your valuing. It's important. Valuing doesn't have to do with your intellect and how smart you are. You can be a genius, but you will still see and interact with what you value. Now, it takes spiritual wisdom to realize you need to change your valuing. There's a higher intelligence, I call it the voice of reason, the reason within us, that tells us, look, this, let me show you why I say this is valuable and this isn't. And it sorts it out for you. The voice of reason sorts it out for you. So you start to change your valuing based on this very compelling presentation by reason. It works with you in a fair, honest, just, patient way. And it says, just compare this and look at this, and you know, do you value this or do you value that? This is the way, this is the path. It's the path that I've taken, it's the path that I've seen work, and it's the path that absolutely addresses. It is the pragmatic path. And, my religion is pure pragmatism, okay, that's it. I don't follow any other religion. I'm not a partisan, I'm non-partisan. I simply follow pure pragmatism. What works? What works? And I do have a basic curriculum book that shaped my direction and helped me a lot, which is A Course in Miracles. And I do believe it's by Jesus, absolutely. And this book and Jesus is super incredibly pragmatic, just pure pragmatism, an honest, clear explanation, and just says, look, just examine this in the light of reason and ask yourself, you know, what do you value? And gradually you sort out your valuing, and your valuing starts changing bit by bit by bit by bit by bit. Not fast. You don't suddenly have a completely different value system. No, it's gradual, slow and gradual. like for instance, music. I used to be a complete musicaholic. completely addicted. My entire life was wrapped around music. I thought music was life. Truly. And everything else was nothing. This is exactly, I valued music totally. Totally valued music and didn't really value anything else. And so I thought my goal was, my purpose was to convert the world to my viewpoint of music is God. You know, music is what we need. If we have the right music, we'll all be happy. And this is the way society and life and the world should be structured. Literally believe that. So it has been a very difficult thing to change my valuing. Now I see the vision of oneness is actually where value is. Where value is. It's the only real value there is we have here. And it's not like I don't listen to music occasionally. Sometimes I'll listen to a song or two and then that's it. But I'm much quicker to just say, okay, that's enough. And let's get back to what's important here. And so I've been able to overcome this overwhelming addiction with music and valuing of music that was just has caused me severe problems. Actually, it's a wrong value system. Ultimately, it's very wrong, and it gets you into amazing how many troubles people get into through their valuing of anything other than a vision of oneness. When you value something other than that, you're actually valuing the ego. You're actually valuing the ego. Because the one thing the ego doesn't value is the vision of oneness. The ego says there's no value there at all. I don't see it. It doesn't exist. There's no such thing. This is crazy lunatic talk. Let's go look at something that does have value. And so most people never quite look at it. I always used to look at the vision of oneness and say, that's a bunch of, you know, new age spiritual talk. You know, that's not music. Come on, let's look at what's really important. That's exactly how I was. So I don't have any judgment on people who struggle with this, because I totally struggled with it. You know, I rejected a lot of stuff that now I'm saying, yeah, I was wrong. I was wrong, for sure. And I tell you, the best attitude to have on the path is to admit that you were mistaken, that you were wrong, you were mistaken, and that's great, because now you're less likely to continue those mistakes in the future, right? So it's a wonderful day when you can realize that you had been duped, you've been wrong, you made mistakes, you've been wasting time. The more you realize that, then you'll find your path is just really lightening up. Because you're able to forgive yourself for that, and you realize, wow, it was all because of the continuity fear. All because of this severe continuity fear that we have. And that's another area that the ego doesn't touch upon at all. Okay, so we have our valuing, the ego doesn't touch on, the vision of oneness, it doesn't touch upon. And the continuity problem, it doesn't touch upon. It leaves those completely out of any spirituality that it's endorsing. It just leaves them out. So here I am talking about this stuff and people don't know what I'm talking about. What are you talking about, continuity problem? What's that? What do you mean valuing precedes perception? And what do you mean vision of oneness? Exactly, you know, it is supremely difficult. And if your valuing isn't there, then for sure, you're not going to be able to appreciate it very much. That is just fact. I didn't appreciate it in the past either. I just said, it's just words, you know, Jesus is talking, I can't quite understand. I sort of follow it intellectually, but I just can't understand what his emphasis and what, you know, what is so important about this and that. And gradually you stay with it. And listen to the Holy Spirit, and you start getting wise, because you're listening to reason, the voice of reason. And the Holy Spirit just points stuff out and is always educating you, like about your valuing, always. The trouble with this world right now is there's a great effort to put us all into a certain system, value system. And that value system doesn't value vision of oneness, Holy Spirit, voice of reason, continuity, problem awareness, and understanding that valuing precedes perception. Doesn't value repentance, doesn't value all the key elements that result in a successful spiritual pilgrimage to the vision of oneness and ultimately freedom from this horrible delusion of lack of identity that we have. You know, we think we have identity. No, we have a lack of identity problem. Because there's only one identity. And when we don't realize that, then we definitely have a lack of identity problem. we don't remember who we are. We don't know who we are. We've forgotten. And the world gives us all these false identities, this body, this car, this house, this relationship, these friends, this career, this free time, recreation, hobbies, books, movies, television, songs. This will help build your identity. No, it doesn't. It just makes us even more confused. I remember I used to go around in school. I remember in the first year of college, which was my only year, because I said this is enough of this. I just went around and say, "Who am I? I don't know who I am. I don't know who I am." It was just this terrible crisis. I just don't know who I am. Because they told me that this oneness is not your identity. They say, that's God. You're not God. You're this human being. You have a human identity. And I said, I don't know. Human identity, I don't know what that is. I can't find my identity. So I had this identity crisis. I couldn't find who I was. And still don't know. But the vision of oneness reminded me, the glimpses I've had, I suddenly say, oh my gosh. That reminds me of the identity that I was convinced wasn't me. You know, the world pressured and convinced that it's not you. You're human. I said, nah, I'm not a human. They kept working on me like torturers, you know. So there's only one shared identity. There's one identity shared by all. And we think that having this human identity makes us superior to that. The thing is, there is no human identity. There is no person identity. There is no person identity of the personality. Those are all defense structures. So when they say you've got a human identity, they mean all those defense structures are your treasure. Those are your treasure. Here's your treasure. You're born in the world. People say, we got this big, you're so precious, we have this big treasure for you. They say, here, you gotta learn this. It's all defensive techniques. Now, if you learn those techniques and think you need to be good at them and everything, eventually you're going to value them, and then you'll feel that this defensiveness is your identity, and what you're defending against is your enemy. That's what happens. It happens to anybody that falls into this. Happened to me, happens to everybody. So we're all in the same boat. We all have the same problem. And in fact, we all have exactly the same continuity problem. It's exactly the same for everybody. We can't remember who we are. We can't remember reality. We cannot remotely remember it. Not even remotely can we remember it. And this world doesn't help us out at all. It's the Holy Spirit, the grace of God, that helps us out remember reality by changing our valuing that orients us to right spiritual practice, which orients us to the vision of oneness. That is how the path works. And that's all that Jesus is saying. That's all that any teacher is saying. It's all the same. It's the grace of God that we become aware of as this very purely pragmatic, reasonable inner awareness that very gently kind of helps us sort stuff out, starts sorting our valuing out, starts working on our valuing out. Wait a minute, is that thought valuable? Is that notion valuable? Is that direction valuable? Is this argument with the ego valuable? Is this how I'm supposed to be spending my time? You know, you start gradually, slowly saying, wait a minute, you know, maybe I see some things aren't right. You know, the way the ego is, something isn't quite right, and you start sorting it out. You're valuing stuff. It reverberates and is super helpful. And then that leads you to the vision of oneness. You've reoriented your valuing, right spiritual practice, vision of oneness. You're cured. Continuity problem is cured. That is the path. That is the pilgrimage for everybody. Now, it seems like, you know, people call this, give different terms to all this stuff. No matter, you know, wherever you are in the world, it's like they give different terms to H2O, right? There's different languages, different cultures, they call it different terms. It's the same water. It's the same H2O. And people fight and argue over terminology, which is something that I just abhor. You know, nobody owns God, okay? Nobody owns zero density, zero dimensionality. Who can own zero dimensionality? Who can own zero density? Who can own pure spaciousness? Who can own everywhereness? There's no ownage to it. It is what it is. You can't trademark it, you can't copyright it, you can't own it, you can't make it into a product, you can't crystallize it, you product, package it, sell it, you can't do any of that. Nobody owns it. But people love to make symbols of it and pretend that they own God and then beat up other people who don't respect their trademark and copyright. Yeah, that's the history of the world, isn't it? Makes them feel they're greater than God. I got God in the bottle. I got God in the church. I got God in a book. I got God here. God's here. I own it. You don't have it. You got to pay me. Pay me for God. You got to give me your money in order to get God. You know, that kind of stuff. So they try to establish monopolies for the purpose of getting a feeling of identity, like, hey, they say, I don't have identity, but if I can just own God, maybe I'll get an identity. So they say, no, our God is the real God. Your God is not the real God. our whatever is the real thing, and yours isn't. It's like arguing over water. You know, what do you, you know, our term, water is better. Some say, no, agua is better. And fight over this term. Who's going to own the term? Who's going to own the water? You know, nobody owns the water of God. It's omnipresent. How can you own omnipresence? Think about it. How can you turn it into a product? How can you turn pure spaciousness into a product? It's everywhere, without exception. Equally everywhere, without exception. So whatever product you have is equally in that product and is equally in not that product. It's all the product. God is the total product. The total product. God is the perfect product. And we have it. We already have it. Everything, everyone, everywhere already has the total product of God. Already. Forever. It's impossible not to. So, eventually we stop. Our valuing gets us to realize this, and we stop. We kind of drop all that ridiculousness, and forgive ourselves for it. And say, wow, that I'm glad I'm not still, you know, screaming at people, because you know they don't use the exact same terminology I do. It's like that. Because ultimately it's the grace of God that leads us back to God, leads everyone back to God. Everyone back to God. Doesn't matter what their talk and terminology is, Holy Spirit will lead them back. No question about it. Because the voice of reason is unmistakably clear, and everybody is within everyone. And everyone can respond to it. Everyone can get it. No question about it. Everyone. There's nobody that the voice of reason, the Holy Spirit, grace of God cannot get properly aligned, turn their valuing around towards the vision of oneness. Everyone will be turned around. I'm totally positive of that. Not one will fail. Not one. Failure is impossible. It's not an option. So we can forgive the future. You know, we think about forgiving the past. I'll tell you something. It's more important to forgive the future, because the future is a lot worse than the past. It's a lot crazier than the past, that is for sure. It is absolutely bonkers, the future. So forgive the future. You know, start out forgiving the future. And then, you know, we talk about forgiving the past. Okay, it's gone, it's done, we forgive it, we'll finish with it. Well, if we forgive the future, it's gone, past, and done with it, we're done with it too, right? So be done with the future, you know, along with the past. But for sure, the future. Good Lord, the future is if they made a movie of it, you wouldn't believe it. It's so strange, you can't even make a movie of it. They've tried, you know, but and it's all silly. It's all totally silly. It's just a bunch of silliness is all it is. That's all it is. The past is just a bunch of silliness. The future is just a bunch of silliness. So forgive it right now. Just say, I forgive the future for all the silliness that it is. And I don't value it at all. The future has no value for me. I don't have a future problem, I have a continuity problem. The future has no value for me, only the vision of oneness has value. Wow, that just hit me hard just immediately. So, I don't have a future problem. I have a continuity problem. The continuity problem is the only problem that I have. The future problem, the problem of the future has no value. Problems of the future have no value. The future has no value for me. No value. The future has no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value. I forgive the future. Let it go. The silliness problem has no, it's not a problem for me. I don't have a silliness problem. I have a continuity problem. It's the only problem I have. I don't have a silliness problem. The silliness problem has no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. Immediately, as soon as I start doing this practice, something just shifts. Because what you're doing is you're using your will, declaring your freedom. You're owning your will. Stunned by this, I'm just stunned. I know. That's what happens when you reclaim your will and realize that you couldn't give it away. You own it. You say, I can't give it away. I can't give it away. I can't give my will away to the future. It's impossible. So the future has no value to me whatsoever. None. Only the vision of oneness has value. Can't give my will away. It's impossible. The future is all about trying to give your will away. And people go through the most incredible gyrations. We do. But people, I mean, that's just a term. I mean, the spirit goes through so many incredible gyrations and jumps through so many hoops to try and give its will away. To try and imprison itself, to try and prove it can separate from its own will, it has the will to separate from itself, to prove that it can separate from God. You see, that's what it's trying to do. And it goes through just, there's no end to the bizarre efforts that it makes. That's all it is. It's just bizarre efforts to do the impossible, which are totally silly and have no value, no meaning. So why even look there? Why look to the future for value? There's no value there. Guaranteed, no value there. Does God need the future to be what God is? Does God need time to be what God is? Does God need the storybook of time to be what God already is? Does God need this to be? Does now need time to be now? Does now say, well, I'm not now yet. I need all this time to be now. God is now. Truth is now. Does truth need time to be now, to be true? Does truth need time to be true? Does truth need the future to be true? Here's the question. Does truth need the future to be true? Or does truth need the future for truth to be true? Does truth need the future for truth to be true? Isn't truth true now? Does every awareness need the future to be everywhere, in order to be everywhere? In order to be everywhere, in order for everywhereness to be everywhere, does it need the future for that? That's a question. Does pure spaciousness need the future in order for pure spaciousness to be pure spaciousness? Is that what it needs? It's desperate. We've got to have the future here, because otherwise pure spaciousness is not going to be pure spaciousness. Is that true? Does zero density need the future in order for zero density to be zero density? Does formlessness need time, the storybook of time, in order for formlessness to be formless? It needs the storybook of time? Why? It needs all these forms doing all these weird gyrations. And for what? Does the absolute need time for the absolute to be absolute? What is it about truth that needs the storybook of time? And if it doesn't need it, where's the value in time? Where is the value? And if you don't see any value, you won't be even seeing the future. Why even see the future if you don't value it? If you don't value the future, you won't see it, right? You'll see the eternal now. That's what's valuable. You'll see the vision of oneness is what you'll see. You'll see the vision of oneness is what you'll see. So the ego values the future very much so. That's all it's got. The ego, the storybook of time is all that the ego has. It doesn't have anything else. It's just a storybook of time that it claims has value. To what? What does it have value to? It has, a storybook has relative value to the other pages in the storybook, and that's it, right? Relative value. Just like this location has relative value in relation to that location. It's called dualism. Dualism, relativism. But the storybook has no value whatsoever to reality. None. It's just that page 10 in the storybook has relative value compared to page 50. Because page 50 is not page 10, is what they say. And page 10 is different words than page 50 or something. But it's all much ado about nothing. So it has no ultimate value to reality whatsoever. It doesn't have any value to omnipresence. It doesn't have any value to omnipresence. Omnipresence doesn't need a storybook of time for omnipresence to be omnipresent. It already is. Already is. Reality already is. reality already is. Truth already is. All reality, every which way you can look at it, already is. It already is. Complete. Complete. The way that reality is the way that it is. So, it doesn't need relativism. Reality doesn't need relativism. It doesn't need the storybook of time to be harmonized with itself. Like, so page 1 harmonizes with page 20, which harmonizes with page 50. You know, all that relative harmony, like this location harmonizes with that location, which can harmonize with this location and all that. There's no need for arrangement, arranging locations, arranging words, arranging the storybook of time. It's just a storybook. Time is just a storybook. That's all it is. It's all it is, just a storybook. You know, like those storybooks we used to read as children. That's what time is. That's what this whole thing is, just a storybook. The days of our lives, the pages of our lives, the pages of this storybook. And it means absolutely nothing to reality. It has no value. None of it has any value. So it's not like you're going to feel you feel estranged, you know, like, oh, I don't have any value. No, time has no value. The storybook has zero value. The entirety of it. It's not one part has value, another part doesn't. None of it has value. Only the vision of oneness has value. Time, I don't have a time problem. I have a continuity problem. Continuity problem is the only problem that I have. The time problem has no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value. I do not have a storybook problem. I do not have a storybook problem. I have a severe continuity problem, and that's the only problem that I have. The storybook problem has no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. The vision of oneness is the only value that there is for me. It's the only value there is, we mean. Okay. So, for anyone who has forgotten their identity, the vision of oneness is the only value there is. And we've all forgotten our identity. The one identity. The one identity. There are not many identities, there's one. And of course, if you're like me, you would in the past you'd say, what are you talking about? That one thing again. What do you mean one? Non-relative, completely. Reality is non-relative. It's non-locational. It's non-definitional. It's omnipresent. It's evenly distributed, you might say. Totally evenly distributed. There's no crystallization of it anywhere. It totally is. It totally gets it. It totally gets it. So, it's one without a second. It's all one, meaning there is no second. There is no second to it. There is no second getting it. Total getting it is total getting it. There isn't any need for any second getting it. Totality doesn't need some other totality. Totality is the totality. It's just one totality, not two. So, the totality gets it. It is the totality. And there's only that. There's only that. And so we are that. We are that. Everything is that. Everything is that. Everything is that. Without a second, without another, without some other. So, there's no relativism, there's no duality to it. This is, and so if you struggle with this notion of oneness, etc., you just be patient and just look at it from different angles, and you know, gradually, you'll feel a little more comfortable with it. The ego uses that term too, for all sorts of nonsense, for the storybook. We're all one in the storybook, you know. Hey, all the pages are one. Look at this book. It's all the pages are. Book has no value. It's like the ego says, it's all one meaninglessness. It's all one nothingness. Yeah, sure. There's no value there. The ego says, yeah, we're all one. We all don't have any identities. we don't have an identity. We've all forgotten our identity. We're all one. The ego tries to place this notion of oneness on all this meaningless stuff, all this meaningless stuff. Hey, I forgot my identity. You have too? Hey, that's great. We're one, aren't we? Yeah, we're one in our forgetfulness of our identity is. And they try to make identity based on everyone forgetting our identity. So the ego wants us all to have this world where everyone's completely forgotten their identity. And they say, hey, we're all okay with that. That's the ego's goal. We're all totally okay. We've completely forgotten our identity. And we're all one in our okayness. And we all reassure everyone, hey, it's okay. You're special. You don't need, we know you're so special. You don't even need an identity, right? You don't need to remember the one identity because you're so special. That's how we're taught. You're so special. You don't need to remember your identity here. So everyone says, oh, okay, yeah, I'm special, that's great. Yeah, I'm special, you're special, we're all special. We don't even need the one identity because we're special. Very, 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 very special. Yeah, how special we need to be to not have any identity. that's really special, isn't it? In fact, it's impossible. But what they're saying is you're special means you're impossible. Congratulations, you're impossible. You're totally irrelevant, congratulations. That's what they really mean. You're so special, you managed to become completely irrelevant to reality. And the vision of oneness shows us that our irrelevance is irrelevant to reality. Our irrelevance is irrelevant. Our attempt to be irrelevant is irrelevant. It's like we're saying, I do not exist, I have no identity, and reality says, you're saying that you have no identity, that has no identity to it. That has no identity to it. I don't have my will, I threw it away. And reality says, no, your attempt to throw your will away had no will in it. had no will in it. Can't throw your will away. You can't throw your identity away. We cannot throw. There's only identity. Identity is all there is. There's only identity. Everything as it is identity. So how can we throw it away? Where can we throw it to? Everything, identity is omnipresent. Well, how can we get rid of that? Where do we hide omnipresence? And again, all this talk, you know, will go in one ear and out the other, mostly. But gradually, some starts sticking here and there. And you know, you just start saying, huh. And then your attention's a little different. Your valuing's a little different. And it builds momentum. It builds momentum. It builds momentum. And I'm still building momentum. And you have to do that. You have to build momentum on the path. Build momentum. Keep on trying. Keep trying. Keep trying. Keep trying. I know there's a belief that people think, oh, somebody uses the term oneness, oh, they must be so enlightened, they must not. No. Many, many people have talked about oneness and they're not enlightened. But you could say they're trying, you know. But I would prefer it's presented in this way of trying, instead of saying, I'm going to write a book about oneness, and this is, you know, this, as if they know they're abiding in the oneness. You know, some are not. But it's better to show the struggle, the actual struggle of the path. The path is a struggle. The path is a struggle. It's not that somebody can say, I think I can use better terms for oneness, and so I'm going to write a book and say, these terms are great, that's it. But people think, so it's easy for them, there's no struggle. That's not true. It's not true. Everybody struggles with it. Someone may have had a peak experience. They say, the oneness, I experienced the oneness, and then spend the rest of their life writing a book about it or something. No, that's not the way. You have the oneness, you say, hey, I forgot. I forgot. Doggone it. let me, I don't like that. How, why did I forget it? Let me work, keep working on it. I don't want to forget this, you know. How come I, you know, you keep struggling. You keep struggling. That's the path. You keep struggling. You keep struggling and you keep working at it. There's no substitute whatsoever for this right effort, right effort, right effort, right effort. No substitute for it. Here comes the helicopter again. So, the future, let us forgive the future ahead of time, let us forgive it now. Let us say the future has no value. The future is not, I don't have a future problem, you can say that. Why not? This is the risk you take. But on the path, you have to take the next step. You gotta do it. You got at some point, you have to be courageous. You have to use your will. You must go past the feebleness. And you think, oh no, it's too difficult. Nobody else feels this way. Oh, these other people, that is easy, but exact opposite. Feebleness is always there. And it's always, you have to gather your will and say, I'm gonna go past this feebleness. I'm not gonna let it stop me. I can make an excuse, easy to make an excuse. But you say, no. The future is too much. I don't want it. I don't want to value it. So let's say, hey, I don't have a future problem. I have a continuity problem. The continuity problem is the only problem that I have. I have no other problem. The future problem has no value to me. None. Absolutely none. Totally devoid of value. The future is totally devoid of value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. The vision of oneness is the only value there is for me. And the vision of oneness resolves the continuity problem for me. So when you start actually saying this about the future, this is profound, actually, very profound. Because you're basically saying, I'm not going to see that future. I'm not going to even see it. Not going to even be there for me. Not even going to be there for me. Won't even see it because I have no value. Have absolutely don't value it in the slightest bit. Don't value it in the slightest bit. Now, people may have, you know, various reasons to start thinking about this. Just when you do the practices, don't let all these extraneous thoughts think. Don't think about it like in that way. Like, what about this? What about this? No, just stay with the practice. Let it have its effect. If thoughts arise, say, there's no value there. Oh, is that the vision of oneness? Oh, no. No value. No value. No value to those thoughts. Okay, well, we'll wrap this one up, and maybe I'll do another one later on this evening. Maybe, you know, it's good. Here's one thing. In the morning time, get started right. And we all have trouble with this. I messed up this morning. Don't look at the newspaper in the morning. That's the worst thing. Don't turn on the television. Okay, those are two things. Those are huge no-nos in the morning. Start your morning with some meditation, with some concentration. Do not get involved with the news, the television, the newspaper, the internet news. Don't go on the internet. Think about what your dreams and what they were showing you and what the Holy Spirit, the practice that gave you in the morning, if you asked for that. And start working on that and start building your momentum for the day. And your day will be way more successful on the pilgrimage. You'll get go further than if you say, well, wait a minute, I want to read the newspaper, this section, this section, this section. And before you know it, you say, oh my God, all this terrible news, all this emotionalism is in your mind. Now, one more note here is that avoid emotionalism as much as possible. If you can't stay calm about something, truly calm and detached, then avoid it, some issue. Emotionalism makes fools out of everybody. It's ruinous for us. Example, the Malaysian plane thing. I should have avoided it altogether. Someone mentioned it to me. I was avoiding the news completely, and I've been following a little bit. But I shouldn't have. It was a mistake, of course, because it's a super emotional issue. And it's really emotionalized the world. It was one of these things that emotionalizes the world. Now, when you get emotional like that, you can't think straight. You can't reason properly. For instance, the people are still screaming, give me evidence, give me evidence. Well, where's the evidence? You know, I don't believe until there's evidence. Well, what do you mean there's no evidence? They've now determined that the last ping was way out in the super remote area of the Indian Ocean. Okay, now, they've also determined that at that point in the Indian Ocean, the plane would have been out of fuel too. Okay, then it didn't ping anymore. Okay, the plane's out of fuel, it's a remote part of the Indian Ocean, the ping stopped. Now, in order for that plane to be someplace other than that, it would have had to fly to the nearest landing strip, which is about, you know, what, I don't know, 1,500 miles away. It didn't have the fuel to do that. So it dropped into the ocean. That is the evidence. Reason is evidence. And people in emotional state can't even see it, can't even see this, that the plane was out of fuel at that point. It didn't have enough fuel to fly anywhere else, to some other place. It was out in the remote area of this ocean with no near landing place at all, out of fuel. It goes down into the ocean. And it's like the OJ verdict, you know. People got so they wanted to emotionalize things so much, people couldn't even think straight. You can't think straight when you get emotional about stuff. So you have to be dispassionate. Even whatever you're talking about, you must cultivate dispassion. Which means not that you don't care, that you're not emotional about it. Remaining calm in the mood of repentance, because you say, I have a severe continent problem, that's what I need to work on. There's other stuff, I don't really need to work on it. It's not a problem I have. But this event of the plane has emotionalized the world. I think this is part of the reason it happened, which makes people incapable of sorting out really tricky situations, which is what's going to come in the world. Very tricky situations. When you're emotional, you can't figure it out. You can't figure it out. You can't see it. So the best thing to do is to sit quietly and stilly and avoid emotionalism. So I might be doing some videos for sharing them with the world, where we're going to sit quietly for a long period of time each evening, maybe. I'm thinking of this. And we will avoid any emotional topic, those kind of topics. I know I did some videos on the false rapture, etc. Like that can be very emotional. I believe I will, you know, once I've said what I need to say, that's enough. And we will spend our time being very dispassionate, very calm, very focused, and we need that. We need it. We need to be very easily see, that's not it. That has no value. I don't need that future. That part of the future, I don't need. That part of the future, I need. I don't need the future. The future has no value. The future doesn't have any value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. So the best thing anyone can do is to sit still, sit quietly. It's the best. Sit quietly, with a quiet mind, quiet body, mood of repentance, serious, calm, sober, non-reactive, non-emotional, non-argumentative, non-imaginative. Just be quiet. Just sit still and be quiet. Don't entertain the problems of the world. Don't entertain personal problems. Don't entertain any problems at all. Say, anytime a problem comes up, will say that this problem, this personal problem has no, I don't have this personal problem. I have a continuity problem. This personal problem has no value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. And you just practice that. Just practice, be quiet, practice the continuity technique, and maybe a little bit of, some talk, but, and just stay in that calm, quiet mode. And this is the very best medicine of all, for sure. Punjaji, the great teacher, the great guru of India, was asked, could you give some advice to everybody? What is the best thing to do? He says, just sit. Just be, sit and be quiet. It's the very best. That is true. It is very true. Easier said than done, isn't it? That's for sure. Easier said than done. Because then, Jesus said, the vision of oneness comes to a quiet mind. That's what Jesus said. The vision of Christ comes to a quiet mind. A mind that is quieted down. How do we do that? Every problem that arises, we say, I don't have that problem. If we don't have that problem has no value to us, then we don't need to think about it, do we? We don't need to think about it. We don't need to engage it. We don't need to be bothered by it, actually. But the continuity problem, yes, we do have that problem. So we're not denying we have no problems, because then ego will seize upon that. And when you are afraid of the continuity issue, the ego will claim that means that truth, you don't like it. You don't want to go back, because obviously, the only problem must be you must not like it. So it turns it then back, turns away. It's easy for the ego to turn you away from truth when you don't recognize you have a continuity problem. So it's crucial you recognize that your reluctance is due to the continuity problem, not to the corruption of truth, okay? It's all important. So admit, I do have a severe continuity problem, but it's the only problem I have. And the vision of oneness is the only value that I have. Only that is value to me. Nothing else has value, actually. Nothing else. Because the vision of oneness solves the only problem I have, and I have a super severe problem. So it's super important. Vision of oneness is super important. Super important. And we just continuously just focus on that. Focus on that. And everything else calms down, quiets down, and leaves us. All this other stuff leaves us. All right. So I will see what I can do. I will see what I can do. Because I know this is the most helpful thing that any of us can do, is to the discipline of willingness to sit quietly, listen to some talk, do these practices, do the practices, actually do them, and it will transform your situation, and you will find that you don't even need the future. You don't need the future. You don't need it. There's no value to the future anymore to you whatsoever, and you will sidestep it that way. And you will thank God that you've sidestepped it, because the future, again, is beyond bizarre. And I don't mean in a good way. Not in a good way at all. And it really is nothing that we're interested in. Like these movies that they show trailers. I have zero interest in these movies. Zero. It's just, you just realize, oh my God, no, I'm not going there. Been there, looked at it. I know that's not what I really want. That's not what I really want at all. What I really want is the vision of oneness. Period. When I got the glimpse of the vision of oneness, my reaction was simply, this is what I really want. 100%, that was the feeling I had. If you want to know what the feeling is like, how can we compare it to any other feeling? Because no other feelings we have are the feeling of, this is exactly what I really want. Nothing. We never have that in the world. So you can't really define it or explain it, because we have nothing to compare it to. There's nothing in this world that we say, this is what I really want. And it's honest and complete and true. No way. No way. It's all relative. But when you see the vision of oneness, it's non-relative. You say, this truly is exactly what I really want. This is it, and you know it. And that's a different feeling than any other feeling that we have. You cannot, it's apples and oranges. You can't compare it. You cannot compare it. this is what I really want. The vision of oneness is what I really want. I really don't want anything else. I only really want the vision of oneness. That's it. That's what I really want. You can have what you really want. Are you interested in only what you think you wanted as a consolation prize for not having what you really wanted? No, you're not interested in that anymore. It's like once you realize that you're the identity and not the shadow, do you still want the shadow? No, you're not interested in the shadow anymore. That's obvious, so this is what, vision of oneness is what I really want. The vision of oneness is what I really want. The vision of oneness is what I really want. Perfect. And that's it.